Perhaps in the last week or so, you saw the study that I saw. I think it was in the New York Times, the New Yorker something. It was about a study that was being done on people that had lived to be over 100. Now, the researchers know that there are lots of factors at work in those that live to be over 100. They perhaps have made all sorts of choices about their health and their lifestyle. Some have chosen to smoke or not smoke. Some have chosen other habits that might shorten their longevity. But this study wasn't focused on environmental lifestyle factors. It was focused on the genes. What an individual could potentially be born with that could account for such longevity. Now, implicit in this study was the idea that if information could be gleaned about the genes, that perhaps we could develop genetic therapies. Genetic therapies to enable all of us to live over 100. To move beyond the average span of life that most of us will experience into an 11th decade in our lives. I thought a lot about that, what it would mean to approach that kind of longevity. And I decided I hope this genetic therapy is a miserable failure. I do not want to live to be over 100. Now, don't get me wrong. I love so much about my life. I've got a great family. I'm serving a great parish in the Episcopal Church. And rarely in my life have things been so good as they are right now for me. And I hope that's true for many of you as well. But you see, I don't think this is all that there is. And there are times when I think about where we are in this life, and I'm not so happy with what I see. Even though I'm enjoying myself, even though I'm showered with blessings around me in this world, I see awful things. So I revert to my trust, to my confidence that God has something bigger, that God has something better, better than this world, better than this country, better than anything would possibly imagine, that God has an ultimate vision to do something with us and to do something with all creation to make it to make it beautiful, to restore it to holiness. Now it's funny, as you think about where we are seasonally, moving into Advent as we anticipate Christ's birth, coming among us as a child, you may be surprised that we didn't sing any Christmas carols this morning. No, we started by looking at the end. We started with Jesus. Tell us about the changes and chances of this life and the times and the trials that we experience in this life and that Israel experienced in Jesus' own time. We hear echoes of the prophet Isaiah. Israel had been exiled and they've returned home. everything that they believe, everything they hope for, resides in this returning home to the promised land. And they've arrived. And it's not that great. Things aren't going that well. And they have to step back and think about what they've longed for, what they've hoped for, and the fact that it's not materialized. When Jesus speaks to his disciples in the gospel, painting this gloomy picture for them, the destruction of the temple has either happened or is going to happen. Israel is oppressed by a foreign occupying army. A general is going to walk into the temple in the Holy of Holies, a Gentile, and desecrate it. Israel thinks the world has collapsed. What do you do when God can't be found? When the locus of God's presence on earth has been destroyed and defiled? What do you do when it's all fallen apart? Everything you've wanted, everything you've trusted, everything you've longed for, is gone. Isaiah tells us that's when you hope. That's when you recognize that although you are powerful as people, although there's so much we can do, ultimately we'll rely upon God to do some things. As much as we try, as much as we are educated, as much as we try to make the right decisions in all aspects of our lives, we will not restore the creation to holiness. Only God can do that. It doesn't matter if you're facing the end of your life, or if you're witnessing the changes and chances of history. The poor have always been oppressed, just as they are today. The powerful have always taken from the powerless, just as they have today. Nations have marched on other nations, just as they do today. Sabers rattle like they always have and do today. Saviors promise deliverance and can't offer it, just as they do today. And yet, in the midst of it all, in the midst of all the brokenness, in the midst of all the wonderful things and the horrible things, we look beyond the moment. We long for the time when God will infuse this creation with holiness. And we're called to work for it. We're called to fight against the powers of this world, which destroy and corrupt the creatures of God. We're called to stand up and say, that's not right. Stop it now. And we do so, confident, trusting that we have the grace of God, that we have been given grace as a gift. And the one that has given us this grace will not be silent forever. That God is here. That God is working. God has sent his Son to begin that process of restoration. So God has acted. God is acting. And God will definitively act in history. That's the good news. And not much is asked of you Jesus tells us what we do this day and forever. You stay awake. Stay awake.